Good morning and welcome to our monthly webcast. I'm your moderator, Samir Mehta, and we have another very exciting CTO case for you. This makes it our CTO case number 7 amongst the 46 live cases. I also have a personal observation to share with you, which will help you along with your training and guidance in the cardiac cath lab. The Mount Sinai Cath Lab is an exceptionally busy place. They also do numerous complex cases. This is the 16th year of their coronary complex interventions. And this morning before coming here, I went and checked on the board and they have 58 cases scheduled just for today. You will notice that in the early part of our CTO experience, the first case was done in late 2009 and continued every few months. There have been outside experts who had joined us. These included Dr. Ochai, Dr. Kimura, Dr. Bill Lombardi, and Dr. Craig Thompson. Why do I make such a big deal out of it? Because so many of you who are trying to become experts in CTOs, this is exactly how you need to begin. Bring in some experts who are better than you and gradually escalate with your strategy, and hopefully soon you'll become not only experts with the anti-grade but also with the retrograde. We'll also learn this morning about some other finer techniques, but let me take you quickly to the cardiac cath lab where we can begin showing you some of the practical lessons in CTOs. Sameen, good morning.
Good morning.
I have often referred to people that when you start doing a lot of CTOs, as your cath lab is now doing, you need almost a resident expert. And not only in Dr. Kinney we have a resident expert, but now we hear very often about the Kinney retrograde technique. This morning, I think from the basis of what I have seen, you're looking at primarily an anti-grade procedure.
Well, yeah, I mean, just to say the very important point that to get to the next leap of CTO success, you need to learn the retrograde. Now, again, I mentioned in our presentations in the past, the retrograde is usually a third approach, third attempt. First and second should be anti-grade, because no matter what you do, retrograde will have slightly higher complication and a little more retrograde dissection. So clearly that you want to give anti-grade approach first, except in the ostial lesion, let's say ostial RCA, you can't engage. So there, you have no choice, go with the retrograde. Many times with some of the ostial LAD, where you have no stump at all, maybe the retrograde as the first try, but by and large, retrograde need to be kept as the second or preferably third attempt. Now just to give this brief background, of the retrograde, when we try to get to the next level, that we actually got our Japanese expert Dr. Ochai and Dr. Chukani. They both came on multiple retrograde cases, which were the tough or failed anti-grade. And I can tell you the history of Mount Sinai. The first 12 retrograde tried by the Japanese expert, I'm not blaming or saying what it is, but the cases which we left, of the 12, only one succeeded. But then over the years, we learned our own technique, and now you can see Anu has become the expert within the own way, modified retrograde technique, and now we routinely do retrograde cases. No longer is a special thing. It has become routine. And therefore, retrograde definitely require extra skills, and you have to do anti-grade about 200 plus cases before get to retrograde. But more important is retrograde should not be start as a first line approach. And this is what we are going to focus in our symposium also. As you have mentioned that there is a lot of demand in our live webcast for the retrograde. And in our June symposium, we actually have kept few sessions for the CTO, and few of them will be the retrograde. Knowing the retrograde sometimes can take a little extra time.
Sameen, this goes credit both to you as well as to Anu for having the humility, despite such a depth of experience of over two decades, to bring in experts to learn techniques from them in procedures such as CTOs. And I'm sure you modified and used the same pattern for structural heart disease also.
Absolutely. And maybe we can ask Anu to make a comment on this, the retrograde.
Well, she wants to proceed on with the case. We'll bring her on later. Quick question also. You've also, I've noticed, set other trends which did not appear so significant till now. Everybody is talking about it, about cardiac cath labs functional on 6 or even 7 days a week. And I know you've been doing that for at least 20 years.
Yeah, actually, I would say 6 days. You need the...
What is keeping you away from 7 days? You don't need to be... You don't need any rest or
the machine,
day off?
No, machine needs a rest. Not us, because we give the manpower. You can always change and strategize. But I think the machine needs... There is a lot of push from our hospital. They say, why don't 7 days? Because our volume, every day we are working despite the seventh lab now till midnight. Last night also midnight. Tonight, of course, we'll pass the midnight. Then Sunday do about 25 cases. Key is that you need to give 1 day rest to the machines. Otherwise, they'll break.
So
that's one of the reasons.
It is 12 minutes after 8 this morning. You've got 58 cases. How many have been done already?
No, because today, because of our webcast, we start late. So that first, the patients are in the room in next 15-20 minutes.
So this is an easy day for you?
Easy? Well, no, actually not easy.
Easy because you start lating.
Late, a little late. But these are the 58. We'll have about 6-7 add-ons. So usually we end up in doing average day between 65, around 62 to 68 cases, average 65 per day.
Unbelievable. And you've had humility to bring in experts to learn CTOs, transradial procedures, structural heart disease. Sameen, take us what you're going to show us today.
All right, this complex coronary case is supported by Abbott Vascular, Boston Scientific, Medtronic and AstraZeneca. And these are our disclosures, which are nothing new since or in the past. This is a very interesting young man. And I just tell you that how we follow the guidelines. And this is a classical example. 53-year-old male, he has about 2 months ago vague chest pain with non-specific precordial T-wave changes and associated with variable dyspnea. Sometime he had chest pain at rest, some shortness of breath, sometime he'll walk 2 miles. So therefore, the private cardiologist suggested, actually internist for that matter, said, well, we should do a stress test. He said, no, my whole family said that go for an angiogram. So we do the cardiac cath on him. He did not have any stress test. He's not on a medication. He's diabetic. And of course, he has this history of rheumatoid arthritis. He's taking medicines for it. And we find a CT of mid-LAD with minimal LV dysfunction. So now you have a CT of the mid-LAD, minimal LV dysfunction. You put this patient on the grid. And there was, it becomes inappropriate. So no PCI was done, and patient was inappropriate and discharged home on anti-ischemic medication with the idea that we will get a stress test. So he was put on metoprolol, amlodipine, added, started Crestor, baby aspirin, and of course he was taking his the glucophase. Then we did a stress test on him. And clearly, which is not surprise, but we documented now, moderate size, large anterolateral and apical ischemia. And still has this atypical, typical class 1 to 2 angina. And Anu will take us through the angiogram on this particular case with a CTO.
So this is his LV function, if you see here. It's maybe mild antero, but otherwise it's almost a normal LV function. And RCA is normal. Actually, you only have surface collaterals, not so much subtle to subtle collaterals, but you have total occlusion of the LAD after the moderate size septal.
Difficult guiding catheter with
it's a separate origin of the LAD and circ. That's why we have a very tough guide positioning here. So that's initially, we normally don't like to use FCL, but we use an FCL. It was, you see here, it was just pointing up, which would not give us much support. We have now changed to VL35, and same thing, we are not able to truly engage the vessel. It's just at the ostium. At least more than 20 millimeter long total occlusion, and only negative thing is like we do not have a subtle to subtle collateral to go through retrograde channel if we need it. Then you have this bifurcation LAD, which you see a big dag that's coming just where the total occlusion probably ends.
You have any other view, or that's it?
No.
One view only.
Sameen, as you look at this angiogram, what concerns you besides the technical challenges of the appropriate guide?
Well, I mean, clearly that the guide issue, as we have spoken. Second is that there is a side branch coming at the right. total occlusion, very, very important. The other is the calcification and bridge collateral. We'll go through those. That clearly, that's not the issue here, but definitely a side branch at the occlusion level is associated with the poor success rate of CTO recanalization.
So here is a question for both of you, and we'll let Anu proceed with the case, and you can take us through the slides. What chances of success do you give yourself in this case?
Well,
80%.
Yeah. Well, I would say this is the you know, knowing that we know exactly the area is, although it's a long, I would say maybe in the past was 80%, but now I would definitely give it 90% the first time. Maybe second time we have some dissection, we bring back the aggregate should be about 95%+.
Excellent.
With the first being about 88 to 90.
Excellent. Sameen, take us through some didactics so that there is greater academic benefit to the viewers.
So therefore, with this patient was inappropriate in the past, but because of medical therapy and large ischemia, now truly become appropriate.
Miracle.
And then we'll talk about two of them. Every time, the predictor of CTO lesion success and the correlation of the IVUS OCT and FFR. So we want to show this case live in terms of recanalization. So I'll try to, if need to be interrupted, as soon as we are at that level, when Anu is bringing, this is the which guide? Guide is still 3.5, right?
No, we changed to VL now, 3.5.
Okay, the guide will be the issue.
Yeah. The thing is, he has a bigger root.
Yes.
So that's why.
Okay, now CTO occlusion, we know there are a lot of issues with the proximal cap and distal cap and the calcification. So therefore, all CTOs are unpredictable. Don't cross it. I don't want you to cross. It'll be live. You want to go live right now then?
Yeah.
No, but don't
wait. Been sitting
wait.
There for a long time.
Yeah. The key is that this is our traditional teaching. That anatomic description of procedural success, the favorable and unfavorable. Unfavorable being that there is a stump, there is not a taper, then there is a no side branch. If there is a side branch at the occlusion level, then it creates a less success. And of course, the functional versus the total occlusion functional, they say that there is some anti-grade passage of the dye, which to me is not a CTO. CTO is the total occlusion. There should be no anti-grade passage except with the bridge collateral. And all of them are associated with poor success, including the calcification. And this actually have been shown that clearly that the long lesions, moderate to severe calcification, old total occlusion, bridge collaterals, they're all associated with higher hazard ratio of success. Therefore means a higher chance of unsuccessful. Also have been shown, this is from our CTO PCI registry, that patients with the unsuccessful have a higher complication, rightly so, because you didn't succeed, so probably some complication occurred, you stopped. So clearly that particularly the death, it may be trend towards emergency bypass surgery, stroke, and perforation, much higher in the unsuccessful cases versus successful cases, which is totally expected. More important now is the where we are. Remember there was a registry which we showed 2 years ago, average success rate was 66%. But now with the latest data of the temporal trends published in JACC Cardiovascular Intervention of 16,000 plus cases, there has been a gradient in terms of the success as you see on the top with the blue, that now success rate is close to 80% and the complication rates continue to decline. They are not 0%, but about 0.5%, clearly a 80% success rate. The sum of the data which we got now, which I want to share with you, of the various generation stents and so that which technique should be favored, that is from the Florence CTO PCI registry published in JACC, and basically showed these are the various complications at 1 year and MACE as well as angiographic outcomes, and very important few points in this. There is a very low stent thrombosis, everolimus eluting stent, which is the second generation compared to first of the Texas and Cypher. The EES have a lower restenosis, lower occlusion. More importantly, the STAR technique, that is the anti-grade dissection, associated with higher MACE rate and higher occlusion at follow-up. So very, very important observation that once you do an anti-grade dissection associated with higher MACE rate and occlusion. And this actually goes back here also, that angiographic outcome, STAR technique is associated with higher occlusion at follow-up. also on the various vessels. RCA total occlusion has a higher reef stenosis compared to other. You will feel that maybe LED, but no. Most of the studies have shown that RCA, once you open it as a follow-up, has a higher total, higher reef stenosis than occlusion compared to the LED, which we otherwise would have expected have a higher reef stenosis. And this again to emphasize that you have non-star versus star technique, that at follow-up MACE rate was star 55% versus 77% with a non-star. Star basically means subintimal tracking anti-grade. That's what it is. And if we do a retrograde, we call it a CART. Now, CART also has shown some data that may have higher reef stenosis, but clearly now, first time officially, we have this data of the CART star technique having a higher reef stenosis. And therefore, it goes down to now, this is the NOAAL crossing device of a string ray and cross boss. Now, is done by taken by Boston Scientific, that should you promote this device, which caused tremendous long re-entry and the anti-grade star, again need to be seen, because in the CTO registry, they were not done with a string ray device. So clearly, what will be the data with the current, our string ray anti-grade star technique, we need to see. And this just goes back to that in a dissection and re-entry strategy, I think what basically we learned is that try to avoid re-entry, but anti-grade dissection or retrograde CART technique are still maybe okay. The second clearly quick point on the correlation of the IVUS, OCT and FFR, people keep asking what number is for what, and this is just a schematic of the IVUS and OCT tells you inside the lumen, FFR tells you across the lesion in terms of hyperemia, and of course CFR takes care of the lumen, the lesion as well as the microvasculature. We have the clear-cut criteria for significant stenosis. IVUS of the less than 4 millimeter square, FFR of 0.8, but OCT we do not have any. They actually very interesting study of the first study from Dr. Waxman from Washington Hospital Center of the 10 US Center with 350 patients. They actually in the intermediate angiographic lesion of 40 to 80% did IVUS, VH and FFR and basically found that all vessels, our cutoff which used to be 4, if you take a 0.8, there is a very poor correlation. You see the all vessel in the upper left quadrant, very poor correlation, kind of a scattergram, that even many of the lumen of the 3 or 4, you will have a FFR of, lumen less than 3 and 4, that you'll have a FFR of more than 0.8. But more importantly, what they found is that the FFR is dependent on the reference vessel diameter. That overall it was 3.07, but if you go to a small vessel less than 3, it is 2.8568. If you are at a bigger vessel, 3 to 3.5, the reference vessel, it was 3.16. And if the reference vessel is more than 3.5, it was 3.74. So it seems to be the 4 millimeter which we have actually may not be the true in every reference vessel diameter. And this just shows that there is a good negative predictive value, but the positive predictive value, sensitivity, specificity of this accuracy is very modest at the best. And this actually also gives you the cutoff that if you decide to do PCI, very important, that one on the right side, that is that if lesions that did not undergo PCI with FFR of less than 0.8 and MLA of 3.07, you can see majority of them had FFR or will fall on the right side. Therefore means they did good. Very rarely we do intervention on the patients who have the FFR of the more than 0.8. Very important. Now then, the second issue was correlation of the OCT versus IVUS. Knowing that the OCT is being increasingly used, this actually paper really looked at it two aspects. One, in about 200 plus lesions, that one at the native coronary, that is there relationship with the reference vessel, what you get on the IVUS and the OCT, and the minimum lumen diameter, and secondly, in the stented segment. This is on the native coronary. Very interesting that if you take a reference lumen and reference vessel, the diameter, they were identical on the IVUS and OCT, but if you minimum lumen, that IVUS gives you bigger lumen by 1 millimeter compared to OCT. So therefore, your cutoff, which was 4 millimeter, let's say on IVUS, on the OCT might be 3, but we don't know. But the key is very important for the native vessel, you have 1+ millimeter higher in the IVUS compared to OCT. After the stenting, little busy slide, so I have just put the circles, that if you go to the stent area, in stent lumen, as well as the stent at follow-up, it seems to be identical for both IVUS and OCT. But very important, when the lumen at follow-up, because the neo-intimal hyperplasia, that with the OCT you detect very clearly, so that lumen is smaller on the OCT compared to IVUS at follow-up, largely because of the better detection of the intimal hyperplasia at follow-up. And of course, now we know we are going to the next level, that is a virtual FFR or non-invasive FFR from the defect to steady, that by the CT, there are a lot of programs now that will be calculating the FFR, although the defect to steady, in my opinion, was just a borderline. I would say there was not a great correlation, but at least we have something to work on. And same thing, that negative predictive value and the CT with a 30 to 70% lesion, accuracy is there, but about 70% range. But a lot of work need to be done on this field. So clearly, that the field of FFR and IVUS and OCT will continue to evolve. And more importantly, we will be having information by our non-invasive colleagues of the CT angiography and so, that they may give us some idea that there is a lesion, 60%, but FFR or CT FFR or VFFR, whatever they will call it, that it is less than 0.8 or more than 0.8.
Sameen, excellent review. I'm glad you covered the very fascinating first study by Ron Waxman and its various implications. If anything, it only convinced that FFR remains the gold standard for the functional assessment, and IVUS will probably guide the PCI. Yep. Anu, what is happening with your case?
Nothing. We are waiting.
All right. Let's proceed. This is the same guide, or did you end up changing it?
It's the same guide.
Okay.
Okay. What wire and so you have now?
No, this is the fine cross fielder. I'm just going to the side branch to get the fine cross there.
No, but you may be in the lumen.
No, sir, give me dye.
Yeah.
No, it's I'm not
so
in the lumen.
The side branch.
Yeah.
So we are trying to bring in the septal and try to bring the fine cross just at the lesion. Yeah. So same thing. This is the important point, that if you have a side branch, you probably should bring your device up to there, and then many times if there is an issue, you can always occlude the side branch with a small balloon if that's an issue. But otherwise, we'll try to bring the fine cross, then pull back, and now our stiffer wire you can direct into a right direction. But I think the coming back to this point, while I know it may shaping up, you want to just make sure everybody has commented on. I was in fellows course on Sunday in San Jose, and lot of fellows came. Actually, you know, it doesn't appear on our statistics, but 8 of the fellows approached me that they use this webcast as their the cath lab journal club. I encouraged them to ask the question. I said, why don't you ask? He said, well, you and Dr. Mehta makes it every very clear cut, so that we don't have to ask any questions ongoing.
Well, talking about questions, here is the question coming from you, a very unusual one. Yeah. When was the last time you used a bare metal stent?
Question is for CTO or for any?
For anything.
Well, I know. Actually, we used in our cath lab about 8% of cases as a bare metal. And those are majority of them are patient with acute MI, where we don't know the status of the patient in terms of clopidogrel or I would say the depth adherence.
And large size
and
vessels.
And second is the really large size vessel of 5 millimeter. What we learned is even in a 4.5, because remember the basket proof study where they used the 3.5 was the cutoff of the vessel Lightliner. Size. Even in 3.5 and above, that in the bare, the DES of the, they compare the size, the cipher and little die. Let's see. That cipher and the everlimus eluting stents, the zines, that clearly against the bare metal, that the DES had a better outcome. And of course, the EES of the Zions variety had the best outcome, even better than Cypher. So there's no question at this time. In a native vessel, even a large vessel, you'll have advantage of the DES. Now, only question I have skepticism is in the vein graft, because vein graft data are not that solid in terms of the improved outcome. So that vein graft, I would take a little reservation, but every vessel, irrespective of the vessel size, what we have learned is that the DES is better than BMS. Anu, now we will tell our viewer what are you doing now and what changed?
I just changed to Miracle 6 and advancing the wire.
Okay, now it's the Miracle 6.
So, Sameen, here is a little quiz question for you. A trivia for you. Which country uses the most DES as a proportion of the cases?
Well, I mean, I can tell you in the United States now, the number, last number seems to be around 80+%
In China, 95% of the cases are done with the DES.
That's it.
And the reason there, as well as in Asia, is because the price differential between bare metal and drug-eluting stents has narrowed.
Yes. And actually, in India, it's a big. The India, because the DES cost only now $500, and the BMS cost about $300.
Right.
So with the new scheme, which is being implemented, the $500 for the any DES, it used to be a little different in the past, but now it's the latest since from the government approvals that it's a $500 for the DES and the BMS being about $300.
Sameen, your cath lab is also your showing. I heard from the recording team here that you were doing a live demonstration for some courses in India over the weekend.
Yeah. Actually, on the Friday night we have the relay our NIC, the National
Interventional Council meeting in Calcutta.
Was in Calcutta, and last year I went there physically. This time we said we just relay from here, so that we did a case with the Impala, very complex case. With the Impala guided intervention. Now here, as you can see, and keep talking what you're doing also, so that everybody knows. Yeah, we're trying to see, I think the wire has gone into some diagonal or some small branch.
Yeah, some die. Don't see it at all.
How are the other two parallel programs coming? I notice Dr. Prakash Krishnan is now probably on to his 10th or the 12th case, maybe longer, and Dr. Fuster with his controversies in cardiology.
Yeah, both are doing very good actually. Controversy cardiology with many of the grand rounds, you are in the diagonal. Yeah, is working very good, and Prakash Krishnan's the monthly CCC webcast also quite good, and hopefully we'll have a relationship ACC by next month and so. So that's where we are in process right now.
For our viewers, that is on April the 24th as the next one, and if you have questions, it is the site is info@cccliveCases.org. So you've advanced the wire more probably into the diagonal there.
Yeah, the guide is a major issue.
Big issue.
We can't even get this RCA engaged. Okay, some die.
No, but RCA, then we can change the sheath.
We change the sheath, long sheath.
No, but long sheath, and then let's get the guide catheter, Lima guide. We can get a Lima guide there. We have enough time. 5 French or 6 French?
Take a deep breath.
Good. So for now, as you see, I pulled back the fine cross, and so they're trying to direct. It's a very angulated LED, trying to direct our wire into the LED. Want to give anti-grate injection?
Mm-hmm.
I'll give it, huh?
Now die on the RCA.
Yeah, no, anti-grate, we'll see.
Very hard to make out in that view. Probably
RCA, some die.
Okay, give the RCA injection. I think RCA, we need to get a Lima guide.
Okay.
Okay, give us a diagram. You want to go with the 6 French directly in case we need to get retrograde?
No, we can't do retrograde.
Okay, that's then 5 French Lima guide. We are going to get a little better guide catheter for the contralateral injection. Yes.
Highlighting the importance of having a good bilateral cannulation and viewing. Sameen, how did, going back to the, you mentioned about the case you had transmitted, using the Impella catheter a lot?
Yeah, well, actually, no, we use Impala about two cases per month of our 400 interventions which we do. Give us a co-pilot. Here we have it. About two cases, two to three. But balloon pump about 25 of these high-risk cases. So that Impala, I mean, of course, the whole reason is basically that we learned that many of these cases you can just do without, and that but some cases you really need it. I did another case yesterday with a very poor EF, with a occluded RCA and just left main. We thought we'll use the Impala, but we did not. And patient did extremely well with the intervention.
How has the new Impala 5.0 made?
Yeah,
has it?
The Impala, the CP. Yeah, CP, I would say that it's you know, seems to be a little advantageous, but we are used in a rare cases. But clearly when, I think probably it will have a better role in my opinion in patients with the cardiogenic shock,
right,
which we rarely use, but I think in those cases you need this higher, higher cardiac output.
Particularly the subset of cardiogenic shock with acute MI?
Exactly.
So this is the Lima diagnostic?
Lima guide catheter. So
Lima guide.
Yeah, we are
better
going with the guide in case a little better stability. Because remember, the diagnostic becomes a little soft and so.
Absolutely. Yeah. Okay.
But nothing is fitting it very nicely.
Well, maybe a smaller amplatz, but this is better.
Or you can do a AL.75 anyway, 5 French. Good. Let's go to the other side. Or you want to go to AL.75?
No, I think we're okay.
Sameen, do you end up proctoring a lot of people for CTOs?
Yeah, we are starting the structural, the teaching.
Much better with the guide there.
Yeah. But we are
so
far
clearly away. Far away from.
Yeah.
Take us in.
Okay. So people have a chance to come in, and we'll have a structured. You know, I do it for the rotablator course at present, but within few months we will be starting for the CTO, which in these cases. Particularly, we'll schedule 3 to 4 CTO cases of various varieties, the retrograde and so. And by July, we want to start the structural training on the CTOs.
Excellent. What's your personal view on this? You think a lot of US operators have become as skilled as the Japanese?
Well, I think it's the gap is decreasing, and partly because of the excellent wires and so we have at present. Clearly that the retrograde skill may still be need to be acquired by few, but otherwise the wires have become so good, and particularly with the retrograde now, with the collaterals, with the Sion wire, although there is a one big, very increasingly used wire is the Gawa. Wire in Japan is not here yet, hopefully by year end, which is a combination of all your Miracle and Fielder, one-to-one torque and so. That is being number one CTO wire in Japan now. But Sion with a retrograde wire injection really will help.
Miracle.
Which one? Miracle what? You have 6 already.
No, the Miracle. Get me the Pilot.
Okay, Pilot 50 or 150 or 200?
200.
There are times I also have a feeling that although the skills and the patience of the interventional cardiologist is paramount, some credit also goes to the Japanese patients who are so.
Yeah, that is true. They will be lying on the table for 8-10 hours.
6 hours and not.
And here the patients get restless in 30, in 1 hour.
Well, the patients and the family, and it's a totally different cultural environment.
Yeah.
Are you routinely tracking the radiation exposure for CTOs?
Yeah, every patient. No, actually every case. Every case with the cath and PCI, we mandated to present our air karma and DAPT. Yeah. So every patient is in part of our cath report. And this is actually being worked up in the recommendation from society anyway. So we have incorporated that in every case. Our X-ray technicians go through and present ask the fellow the total DAP, radiation and air karma.
Okay, more questions coming for you. What is your ratio of transfemoral versus transradial CTOs?
Transradial CTO probably close to zero.
Okay, so
but overall radial interventions in cath lab now just about 10%+. As you know, in the US latest one, about 4 years ago, it was 1.7. Now it's about 7% in the US. Compared to other countries where it is 60-70%, US is still remain in the single digits or just low teens.
Well, there is a fascinating position paper on that which came out in Euro Intervention from Marshall Harmon on the position and the status of transradial interventions, with the clear recommendations that it is a preferred strategies for STEMI and possibly needs to be increased for other procedures too.
I think that's I fully agree that many trials have shown it that you know, both the sub-study of the rifle, the of the REVAL, as well as the rifle stacks. But you know, they presented the another study called STEMI radial in ACC. There, they did not show much difference in terms of mortality. What was there in both REVAL as well as in rifle stacks? There was a mortality advantage, but in the latest study of the STEMI radial, they used some more Angiomax, Bivalirudin, and so there was no mortality advantage. But the primary endpoint was the bleeding, which was 7% in the femoral and 1.2% in the radial. So the bleeding point of view, yes. But whether in the MACE point of view is the one really will make it a big difference. And studies have shown that in cases in STEMI, that's where you get the biggest advantage of the radial intervention.
Absolutely.
All right, Anu, tell us what you're changing now.
Now I'm with the Confianza.
Okay, now it's a Confianza Pro, which is 9?
Yeah.
Okay.
So
RCA, injection.
Wire escalations going down Fielder, Miracle Brother, and Confianza now.
Yeah, the proximal segment still remain. I mean, we do not know this. That's where the rarely, if I would say, that you'll need a CT scan or CT angio before your CTO PCI, which many people do routinely and bring those pictures in the cath lab. This will be the case where you know that where the vessel courses, because here it's very unpredictable how is the proximal segment of that LED, because you don't see about 10-15 millimeter of the segment after the septum.
I remember asking this particular question both to Craig Thompson as well as to Bill Lombardi, and you're exactly right. They were big proponents in selected cases.
I think we are going into the diagonal, but that's okay.
No, it's not in the diagonal, somewhere in between, some die.
But I would say the advance the fine cross, then we do anti-grid picture.
You're not in the diagonal.
It is in the diagonal.
Yeah, it probably in a diagonal.
I don't think so.
Go with the fine cross, do a Fogarty, and we'll take anti-grid picture and see where we are. The retrograde is not showing it. Look for an AL.75 guide, 5 French.
I have it.
Okay. Let's bring it back in the guide now. And very important is that if you don't see PVC, means you are likely in the lumen.
Right. That's good news.
Yeah, good news. Okay, we're pulling back. Right? Good. I'm pulling back now and then we'll see. No. We'll just pull back forward. 1 second. Let me pull back in the guide. We'll go integrate picture.
Don't say anything.
Good. Okay. We'll do an integrate picture. Sine. You're in the big diagonal. So that part is done. But now we need to make it where the money is. And that is in the LED. But we are in the big diagonal. And that's what I always say. That do a little over, take a picture, and you'll be able to see the vessel.
Samin, in your didactic, you mentioned reasons to stay away from the anti-grade re-entry. Have you had cases where you had any perforation with the side branch advancement of a wire?
Sure. I mean, the wire perforations with those kind of side branch advancement, yes. We have it. The only thing is we have not mastered the technique of the stingray.
Right.
And now with the limited, you know, they call it a LAST, that limited antegrade subintimal tracking, LAST, that maybe that with this newer devices,
no, give me
it might help you.
300 yeah. Fielder.
I think it all dependent on how much the deep wall injury you have created. Very simple in my opinion, whether it's a retrograde or antegrade, because we don't have much the retrograde data in terms of long-term outcomes and particularly with a technique point of view. But clearly that once you went to adventitia, you will cause so much tremendous inflammation and intimal hyperplasia that those patients will have a higher restenosis no matter what DES you use.
Right.
Yep. And that we learned even in the regular ways.
It's amazing how much progress has happened. I know when Craig Thompson was here, he had just mentioned that he had started on the last technique, and today it's become an excellent modality.
Yep. Okay. Now we are back. Since we are there, the fine cross has been put into the diagonal and advancing the long exchange length radio the fielder now. But idea would be that pull back. Now other question is, why don't we leave one wire in the diagonal now?
No, that's what we're doing. We dilate the LED and we'll be able to
get what balloon we have?
2.5. Give me a 2.5.
5 or 2 or 20?
2.5. 2.5 will go. Once you have the fine cross, 2.5 will go.
So your intent of dilating there is hopefully that will visualize the LED much better?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay.
And then, you know, sometimes you can get that
help
cap.
Directed, yeah. Yeah.
Direct. So yeah, we are using a 2.0 or 2.5 20 emerge.
Right.
They are in some small branch now. They're not in the main branch.
Emerge, crap. Give me the...
Yeah, but that's fine. It'll go.
So this is a question which was the biggest question in 1985 and 86. What's your favorite balloon these days?
Yeah, I think the balloon, the gap between balloon has disappeared.
Okay. So it's price dependent or
Exactly. Yeah, I think that the issue about the balloons has become so slick. And particularly with the advent of 1.25 and 1.20. But overall, all the balloons, in my opinion, are kind of equal.
You use bivalirudin in 100% of CTOs?
CTOs, all PCI for that matter, at Mount Sinai, are with the bivalirudin. And
No concern with bivalirudin and any potential for more dissections, perforations
that
people
use? That we just learned that if it occurs at a lower level and better managed.
And the short half-life of the drug comes in useful.
Very handy, yes. And the 2B3A use has significantly gone down. With the bivalirudin used to be, now actually latest data in last quarter will be around 8%. We are part of the ACC-NCDR registry. Actually, in the country, you'll be surprised that the bivalirudin use is now 68% in this 1,500 hospital with a 500,000 angiogram, interventions. And the 2B3A use is still about like 22%.
This is on that topic, there is a fascinating further paper from Holger Thiele questioning doesn't look to be much benefit of intracoronary use for STEMI either.
Yeah, exactly. I accept that if you do a local delivery based on that infused AMI study, that's the only one left it. Now somehow, you know, this always happens. These are very hydrophilic wire. You try to advance, your guide comes out, it removes everything. And this particular case has just happened.
Well, lesson for people to learn that they shouldn't feel bad that this happens in the best of the cases.
Yeah.
The guide has been a struggle throughout the case.
Yeah.
You have the regular fielder, right?
You know, many years ago, I used to be fascinated and amazed how many more transradial cases were being done in Europe, and Asia is following exactly the same trend with the transradial becoming dominant in parts of China and India.
Yeah, fine cross. I think you can go without fine cross now, and we go with this balloon.
Give me the guideline so that it doesn't keep coming out.
A guideliner now? I think why don't you cross first? Let's go 1 second. I think it will follow that routine now. Let's go with the...
No, like it's keep coming out, the guide.
Okay, then what do you want to do? Guideliner?
Yeah. If you need it, we advance the guideliner.
Okay, therefore now because of the guide coming out, we are going with the guideliner. Gives you that extra support. Bring the guideliner up to the proximal vessel. And now you go with the fine cross then?
Yeah.
Okay.
With the fine cross.
So the guideliner, we already have the long sheath, and now we're going back again with the fine cross.
Well, another question just came, which you've already answered. What anticoagulant was used so far? It has been bivalirudin, and as it was mentioned by Dr. Sharma, that is the preferred agent for CTOs not worrying about any potential for dissection or perforation. So the mother and child, the guideliner...
Yeah, but key is that this... We are very much concerned with this guide support issue,
right.
So that need to be a little better prepared now.
Show me some dye there. Where are we?
Good. Selective injection.
A little better, yeah.
That's okay. We'll be a little damp. Now, also with the guideliner, you always will have a little damp pressure.
No, we don't have the guideliner right now.
Yeah, but as soon as the wire exits, the backing is all a little better there. This is still the fielder wire?
Yeah.
It's still the fielder, yeah.
Do your fellows even track the number of transradial procedures they are doing?
Oh, yeah. Yes. I think most of them are comfortable now. Just because even with the 10-11% of there still become 40-50.
What is the American, that's either in a septal or
yeah.
That's clearly a more encouraging. What is the view of the New York patient? What do they like, transradial or transfemoral?
Yeah, I think that some patients do come with the request for the transradial, but I think still some centers have become leader in doing a transradial in New York, and some have just adopted that, do it in appropriate cases. And I think in my opinion, the REVEL trial was the deal breaker. That if REVEL trial would have shown overall that in this acute coronary syndrome benefit of transradial, I think would have become much more the use. And now knowing that it happens in a selected, advantage was more so the bleeding, and now we know the bleeding is less of an issue and vascular complication with the bivalirudin, so that do we really need transradial in every case?
Well, some people would even argue that the gold standard is transradial and bivalirudin.
That is possible. That's
okay.
Right.
Some dye.
Yeah. Although the sub-analysis from the...
Did not demonstrate,
but yes, it makes full sense. What you're saying is full sense. We need a little stiffer wire.
Mm-hmm.
Which one you need now?
No, let me go back to the...
You need pilot or which one?
No, we go with the Confianza only.
Okay, we go with the Confianza again. You want to get the new one or same?
We had, no? Same is good. Yeah.
Yeah.
Anu, besides the guiding catheter, what has been the biggest challenge in this case?
No, I think just the guide.
Right.
Plus, see the LED is
torches
LED.
Right.
So
and also when you had the fine cross there, in some of the views, I got a feeling as if the occlusion is even more proximal than what, the tortuosity makes it a little harder.
Yeah.
Absolutely. and make sure we concentrate on the hand. As I mentioned, that fellows were very happy that we are every case, we are the picture in the picture, and the cameramans are with Guy Puglisi's team, very careful about and really pay attention that concentrating on the hands and the on the table.
One of these days, I have an intent of showing the viewers what goes into making this show. There are at least 10 miles of cables on the tables next to me here. So your cameraman also is highly talented, and I'm sure that goes to further enhance the quality of the transmission.
Absolutely.
Anu, retrograde not an option?
No.
Okay.
You didn't see any septals. They all are surface collaterals.
So let's be a little pessimistic here. Let's say if you don't do this hair today, what's your plan? Bring him back again?
Yes. Absolutely.
And when would be the timing of it?
Usually we wait about 5 weeks, 5 to 6 weeks.
And how is it, how do you deal with our wonderful friends known as the HMOs?
Yeah, but I mean, this kind of case, otherwise same, it will be a Lima to LED, a single vessel bypass, so that we definitely will get it, we get approval. I mean, this one will be approved.
So when you spoke to the patient, had you mentioned to him a possibility he may need to come back?
Yeah, yes, always. With the CTO, we always say, maybe that's okay. Maybe that's the wire. Let's see where it goes.
Goes back into the same diagonal.
Yeah, that's okay.
I don't think so. It's a diagonal.
Yeah. It's going to the same diagonal, which is okay. Good. We do again, Fogarty once again. Make sure that we are in the same lumen and then give you advantage now with the guideliner being there.
So just augmenting the support with the guideliner.
Yeah. But let's pull back in the guide and we are going to take a picture now. And guideliner actually will give you a more specific, more selective picture now.
Right.
Take a cine. No, not retrograde. No need retrograde. This is the anti-grade. Yeah. Keep it there. And now the distal is in a little small dissection channel, but that is it. You want to just play and see?
That is the 300 field.
No, but why do you need it? We can put a dark and let's go with this.
No.
Huh?
No, if you could do dark.
Looks like the occlusion is exactly where the distal, the tip of the guideliner is.
It will make hot perforation. Take this out. It's in the small dark.
Okay, the question is same. That now you have crossed and you don't want to leave the stiffer wire. If not needed, because those will cause more dissections and perforations.
So going with your principle you mentioned before, had you visualized some VPCs there?
Yeah, so far done.
Okay.
So that's good. Now guideliner, see, sitting at the lesion.
Right, you're virtually looking at it.
Yeah.
The question is, are you too far?
But that's okay. Because we still remain at the level.
Okay, now something.
Yeah.
Good.
That's fine. Just hold everything.
And the distal wire is nicely buckled up, so it adds you the further protection there.
You have the balloon now?
Yep. We are 2.5, 20 compliant emerge.
I told you, don't pull them. They don't cross.
Go. Now the key remains here. If we play the last one, that where is the entrance of your
LED. We see the entrance, the front. No, not this one. Previous one, previous picture. Should we just wire it? We may lose it when we dilate now.
We don't see it yet.
Here.
Okay, but let's bring the fluoro again. So we don't want the wire and things to come back now. Curled up.
which is good.
Still may give. Of crap emerge.
We can look for a 2-0. Some other balloon. You want to just dial it here first?
Okay.
Yeah, 2 or 12 minute, right?
20.
You want to dial it here or no?
Dial it, huh? Initially it went, I thought.
Then you do get a mini track, then fine. Let's get a mini track.
Okay, dial it here if you want.
And dial it here?
Yeah.
Okay. The part of the lesion
is in the guideliner. Push the guideliner out.
Yep.
Probably in the
disc. Now, many times when your nose of the balloon in the lesion, you can always do a low inflation and then it will allow you to go further. And see the guideliner?
Yeah, has guideliner, to be advanced. Guideliner has done better dilatation than the balloon.
It happens few times.
Right.
The guideliner goes and balloon does not go. I said, leave the guideliner there now. I
saw some fascinating cases of people using this technique for STEMI interventions. Large vessels, fogartizing the thrombus with the guideliner.
Yep.
Scrap does not work. Just remember that. Go with 15. 20 was too long.
Yeah, they were going with the lower profile because I think 20 was too long. So this is now 2-0.
12.
Okay.
2-0-12 mini track. They're not putting any patients in any room. Why they're not putting patients in the room? Tell them.
Same issue.
Wow.
Give me the sprinter then. 1.2 or sprinter balloon.
Dial it there. No. And that will be okay. It will go with the dilatation. Hold it there. Just hold it.
Just the angle.
Yeah.
Maybe there's some calcium also at that level. Okay. Yeah.
No, part of that is also we may be subintimal, but we'll see.
No.
Yeah, it will go. It will go now. 12 atmosphere.
Get us a 1.2.
1.25 is sprinter legend. Good. Wait one second. Wait one second. Good. Just one second.
Down. We may lose the LED now by dilating this.
No, but right now we are not at the LED level.
We are.
Okay. Pull back on the guide.
If the fine cross went, the balloon is not going.
Now pull back this balloon and into the fire. Pull back in and go back again. Pull back in again. Yeah, go now. Take a deep breath.
Okay, 1-2.
Okay.
Show some dye. Creating any good or no? No.
Huh?
LED is here. Why don't we just wire it quickly now?
Okay. But you need to open a little bit of balloon, otherwise it will not go yet.
Not even that, this diag is all, lot of dissection in the diag now.
Yeah.
Multiple times.
Yeah, it's an exchange length wire, so we are going to cut it now.
No. Yes. Bring it up.
Bring that balloon. No, bring the balloon now.
Sprinter?
Yeah. So now, the question will come, what wire you need? The LED we see.
Yeah, you will need a fielder or a whisper to get into the
whisper.
LED. But we need give us a fine cross also.
We have the fine cross. Put a whisper, a whisper
fielder,
LED.
Fielder only.
Fielder? I would go with a whisper in this.
Subintimal. Goes more subintimal.
But anyway, whisper or fielder. get up. Good.
This is the lowest profile.
This is
1.2 sprinter. You also get mini track 1.2.
Right.
And mini track comes 6, 8, and 12 millimeters. Huh? 20. Yeah.
20 also now. Wow.
Yeah. Okay. But those were the mini track balloons were the one that were used in expert CTO.
Okay. Now question is, we want to just dilate proximal to the LED because this is at the level of the LED. Want to give a little proximal. Don't go to the LED level. Yeah. Good. But remember right now, if you create a dissection at that level, now problem with this 1.25 is you'll not see the balloon inflation.
You see it now. Just a little bit.
Yeah, very faint.
Very faint. Good. Come at the angle and then we'll see. Yeah, here.
Yeah. You know, angiographically, there did not appear much calcification.
But now you see.
Yeah, I think the cap there is.
A little bit here, no?
Okay.
Yeah, the fine cross ready.
But okay, how are you going to? The question will be now with the guideliner. How are we going to work out?
You can leave a wire and fine cross will go.
Yeah. No, but that it has to go in the lumen of the guideliner. But
we'll work it out.
Yeah. You remember the guideliner is there. So what you do is you can advance the catheter from the proximal end to the our TUI burst, and because it occupies the entire lumen of the guide, it will go through. Although very rarely they can go side by side.
This one is a fielder, probably is better. You want to go side by side?
We have made the curve or no? Wait 1 second.
No, side by side probably is more problem than going through the fine cross.
No, I'm
it
saying.
It can go.
Yeah. Okay. We need to make a very sharp curve. All right, let's go. Let's go to the real stuff. That is the mid LED total. Now, get that 2.5 balloon again. Will be okay because we are going to open that LED diagonal with the 2.5 now. Yeah, let's continue. Good. Just hold on. Get a little die. 1 second, not yet. You advance your fine cross more. Okay, good. 1 second.
Have the fielder. This is not the wire.
Yeah, make the fielder.
Fielder.
Okay.
You have the fielder here?
Okay, now little die here. 1 second, let me get the little. Very little.
Get the fielder.
Yeah.
There.
No, that's not the LED. Uh-huh. We need to go retrograde injection. 1 second.
Oh.
Yeah. Give the retrograde now. No guide came out, sorry.
Major
we need the retrograde guide.
Okay, now are you there?
Little die.
They said we can put patient.
Yeah, put somebody. So we are done.
Yeah.
Now. Good.
Okay. Ready? 1 second. We need to do a magnified view. And delayed cine because we still need to see the LED entry. Retrograde injection, good. Stop.
Right there.
It's taking this turn?
It was.
Wow.
That's why we could not get it.
Band of the band.
Yeah.
You prefer a fielder or a whisper there?
Yeah, right now I have a whisper.
Right.
And Anu will like the fielder, which is fine.
There we go.
But still.
It looks to be.
Maybe we need the fielder. Okay.
Antigrade will die.
Antigrade or retrograde?
No, right
won't
now
see anything. We are in the subtle, small subtle there. We are probably in the LED, but.
Just 1 second. 1 second. Hold it.
extremely promising there. Oops, lost it.
The Pilot 50. Take it out, take
you're
it out.
You're ready with this?
Yeah.
All right.
Not yet, yeah.
You want Pilot 150. Or this?
No, let
want?
Me try with the Fielder. If not, we go with the Pilot.
Okay.
Anu, it's possible that also there is a little dissection right at the origin there.
Yeah. That's why what happened once, that is the drawback when you dilate into side branch.
Exactly.
That you'll create a flap and re-enter into the main vessel.
Right. My question to you is that assuming there is a dissection, which is the best wire then to navigate that?
No, we still try that no matter what, through the dissection plane, if a soft wire can find a lumen, that's the best thing. If not, you have to go to a stiffer wire.
You had much more shape to that wire. Okay, but there you go. It was.
We need to bring the bring it back a little bit.
There you go.
Septal.
The septal, but somewhere around there it curves around. Maybe an anti-grade injection here would help you.
Yeah. Now, if wire goes there, we can do a.
But it slipped off again. There you go.
Question: are we in the LED or another septal that comes off the diag?
Yeah, there's a lot of PVCs there.
Yeah, that's okay. Once you're in the septal, you get PVCs.
Yeah,
okay.
No.
Some die. Retrograde, you're doing?
One retrograde.
Yeah. The thing is,
let's try retrograde.
So much dissection in the diag too.
Yeah. Now guide came out again for the retrograde.
Yeah, that's the dissection of the diag. Okay, now.
I think the entry to the LED is a little more proximal.
Right.
So not at that level.
Okay.
Sameen, any role of IVUS here in this particular situation right here?
I think a lot of people who are IVUS expert in this field try to make sure that will be the opening of the LED.
Right.
Yeah, the Pilot 200.
The question is, where exactly the opening of the LED is? That's the question here.
Well, from the last retrograde injection, it appeared a little more proximal, but it wasn't the best visualization.
Yeah.
You get
now
a sense there.
That I think what we should do is maybe get a nice guide into the right coronary, 0.75. So we'll tell us exactly how far we can come up. Because part of that has been that we are not able to inject very nicely from the retrograde. Okay, now what if we go to this view?
Yeah.
28 RAO cranial 35.
Where the pilot?
No, but I think before you do, let's get the different the guide on the other side.
Okay.
Yeah.
AL points on 5, yeah. 5 French.
So we are getting a better injection. Just one second.
It's 5 French
guide. Okay. Yeah, this is the AL 0.75, so that we need a little better selective injection now. I think that has been the part. One second.
Go forward.
One second, sorry. No, go again. Let me go forward again. Good. Pull back.
That should do it.
No.
Yeah, good. Okay, we are going to get that view. That's very nicely now. Okay. We are going to go now 28 and 35.
Hope the viewers are noting some of these finer things. They appear less important, but it's critical. Using exactly the same view, the guide appears to have moved out.
Low mag, yeah.
The right guide.
Yeah. No, it's good.
That's okay. All right, let's see now. Wish we were more magnified there, but no idea whatsoever.
Nope.
No. It's the same view?
Yeah.
What the?
Exactly the same view.
All I can appreciate is a little more calcification there.
Yeah. Hmm. All right, let's try in this view. Okay. It's still in the top at 12 o'clock.
Okay, what wire you have? Take this out.
Now, this is the one you put?
No, this is the fielder now.
Okay. Let's get the pilot. And then what I would still say, if they're not, that we dilate. Yeah. That dilate the main vessel, we have the with a 2.5 balloon. Yeah, but anyway, this is the pilot.
Main vessel, you mean proximal dilate, to where the diagonal
with
starts?
With the dissection, exactly. We can remove this wire.
Get the other one ready also. Clean the wire. Okay. No, I don't need the wire was not lubricated.
The pilot 50, 150, and 200. Yeah.
Well, another astute observation by some of the viewers. First of all, they compliment us saying it's a very nice case, excellent presentation. The suggestion is if you withdraw the guideliner a little proximally and try to find the
But we talked about it earlier. Maybe guide liner is a little too much.
Can we inject from the right?
Yeah. Let's get the retrograde now.
So is that the fine cross there in the LED, or what we presume is the LED there? You advanced it further?
Yes. Yeah. Now we should be able to see if it's a true lumen.
As clearly is headed. Maybe a retrograde injection here? Or
yeah, we are in the LED.
Yeah, this is the retrograde now.
and some dissection.
This is a pilot wire?
Yeah.
It's a pilot 200.
Pilot 200, okay.
I think there we should get a confianza now. Or we can just do, actually we can use our whisperer fielder.
Take a sine, so we tell.
Sine.
Where we,
okay, go.
Do we back need re-entry yeah. or do we need a...
So here it is sub-intimal.
So near, so yeah. near and yet so far.
9 again. Yeah. Now you need to puncture. So mm-hmm. remember, we are a little bit. How is it? Don't say.
Yeah. No. Probably not.
No.
So, I mean, would you consider dilating that proximal portion?
Not yet.
Okay. Yeah,
but soon we might get to that level.
Right. Well, this is very encouraging. Question is.
Let me see. Don't do the. Give me a new one. It cuts it.
Sameen, I know both of you have been so involved, I think it should be a good decision to stay on with the transmission.
I think so. I mean, with the CTO, always is the issue about 1 hour.
So
we started, let's see. I mean, the key is that we try to get into the LED.
Look, the fact that questions are coming, people are still watching. So I find that extremely encouraging.
Yep.
So softer wire there.
This is the Confianza 9
the
now.
Other way around. Okay.
Yeah. Idea is that we are subintimal and we need to puncture the cap.
Okay.
Here, if we know correctly where it is, then you can think about this could be the case for our stingray or so to advancing and directing.
What about do you have the cross boss also?
Yeah, we do have cross boss also.
Some die.
Yeah.
So between
we're
the
doing
two,
doing anti-grade or retrograde, you want?
No, RCA.
Okay, let's see where we are. Somewhere down there, you go subintimal.
Yeah. Let's take a sine.
No, some die. Don't do
it. Definitely subintimal distally.
Maybe pull back.
Pull back on the right.
Yeah, good. Now let's go back again here.
It's a septal direction. Maybe not.
You need a secondary curve on this wire. That many times that one curve tip is not enough. One curve. You need a secondary curve.
Maybe a whisper can get us in the lumen.
You want a whisper now?
Okay, some die there.
It's a slightly different course, but probably in a septal.
Lot of PUC. Okay. I think we can try this. We have gone through the total occlusion area. Let's get a whisper extra support. Whisper extra support.
No, maybe we are in the lumen. No?
Slightly different course there, or still subintimal there.
After that initial bend, it does become a straight vessel.
Mm.
So like most things in life, this also straightens out as you go along. Hopefully, still continues to course the same.
Yeah. And lot of PVC is there.
Yeah.
I think proximal portion is okay. So let's bring the fine cross into the proximal band, and then we go with the whisper.
Sameen, so far, the game changer has been the guideliner.
Take this out.
You know, the pilot was another good decision to get us into the proximal portion there.
Too big.
Okay.
Get me the 200. You know which one? Progress.
You mentioned the Progress. You've been using that a lot?
Not a lot, but we had to use it mostly for expert CTO trial.
Yeah, but definitely it has been another wire addition.
No, I think here.
Slightly different course there.
No, it's not.
I think many times it just tracks the same.
Yeah.
Look, 3 months later, the patient comes back, he'll have a perfect channel there. You can.
Yeah. No.
Slightly different course there.
Created a lot of dissection in the LED.
Yeah, good. I mean, until now it looks like it's going in the right direction until there. No, here it has to go into the better channel.
Re-enter into a... Yeah, fairly substantial dissection up there.
All subintima. No.
Okay, then I think what we should do, let's just dilate the diagonal at this time and the same. We will try to bring the patient back in 6 weeks and then do maybe at the time of our symposium. Yeah.
Give me the progress quickly.
Huh?
Progress, let me just try re-entry with progress.
But make curve first and then we'll take it out. Okay, the last wire we are trying now is the progress, otherwise we are going to dilate that LED, proximal LED diagonal system. And tack up that dissection and then bring back for the LED later on. You know, same 6 weeks, and that will correspond to our symposium. So we'll do in part of our symposium, June symposium.
This would be a fascinating follow-up to this case.
We did, remember when we had an unsuccessful case
two
in
years,
February?
2 years ago.
About 2+ years ago.
Yeah.
We brought it at the symposium and did it successfully, and then we showed it later on in our webcast. The same, maybe the same pattern we need to do here too. And clearly that you can feel if you're going too much subintimal. What do you think? Give the retrograde?
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
You don't see PVCs.
You want to take a picture?
Okay.
Take a cine.
No, show me, die.
Okay. Yep, this looks good.
You look
very
to
good.
Be in the exactly yep. the right lumen.
And this is
the progress wire makes progress.
Get a grand slam exchange length.
Fantastic.
Good. Take a picture. Sine. Show that. Yep.
No doubt.
Good. Then after we do, we have to take this guideliner out also. The guideliner will not take multiple of them.
Anu, just fantastic decision to move to the progress wire. I'm still wondering as to, it has to be a gut feeling which made you do that.
Yeah, it's just basically because she needed to penetrate into the cap.
Yeah, I mean, she was very insistent that, look, she wants to give that a shot before we...
Good.
Just excellent choice there.
Our 2 point, actually, you know what,
so give me Samin, a 2. It is increased
30 balloon.
Increase your challenge. You have to look harder for another case for the symposium now. Good problem to
That's
have.
That's okay. Good problem to have. Yeah. Get a 2.30, right?
This is absolute a great tribute to the stamina of both of you, the patience of the
wire broke.
Patient.
Yeah. I knew that.
That's okay. That's okay. We can leave it. We can leave it. That's okay. Nothing will happen to this wire. That's okay. One second.
Just take it out. We don't teach it. Give us a new.
Okay. Give us a new grand slam.
The tip of the wire
is destroyed.
Yeah.
Okay.
It's just that you don't want to leave it in a small branch there.
Yeah. Right. See that broken at the tip?
Take it out. I was looking at it going in.
You know, reviewing the case, I can tell you that several physicians would have backed off after the visualization of the dissection there, and probably one of the other lessons to learn from a case like this, dissections are really often in such cases no reason to completely abandon.
Yeah. I think when if you got little perforation, maybe that's the time
story.
To abandon. Yeah.
Right. But just a heightened degree of caution, I think, is all right. But these days, some of these micro dissections are not really the reasons. A lot of these wires will create those false entry channels.
Want to see?
So as you attempt balloon dilatations progressively, you keep the guideliner there or
take it out? We may have to leave it just at the little bit at the oscillator.
Come back a little bit and
because the guide, you know.
Many good decisions along the way, I think, to augment the visualization of the amplets. I probably said it too soon, even that's dropped out.
Just make sure you're okay, then we take it out.
So important to have a contralateral.
Absolutely.
And not only that, to try the third guiding catheter. This is the third guide for the right.
And it's still coming out.
Right.
It's
and to continue. No, but it illustrates the same meticulousness which is needed in these cases. You cannot be sloppy. You know, two highly skilled people working with meticulous attention to small details. Just
balloon first.
Hopefully this has been excellent. There you go. You have a dissection plane, one can see, but hopefully in the
we
nice.
Go with the distal first.
True lumen, yeah.
Yeah. Go all the way distally up to 3 o'clock. No. Good. Hold it there.
Went through there.
No, I don't want to give up. Let us see if there's a flow. No?
Yeah. No, we'll be go further. Yeah, that's okay. We're doing a low
I'm
pressure.
Happy
it's a 2.
Wire.
You're there, good. We saw it.
Okay, good.
1 second, just a low pressure. It's a 2-0.
Just want to be sure you're in the, okay.
Low pressure, 6.
Yeah, I think you're just fine there. The dissection plane is much more proximal.
Pull back now. Good.
Done. I don't think what you should do is just stent across. Leave the diag the way it is.
No, but we can dilate the diag and then we put a stent across. Good. Yeah. Yeah. I think you should take the fine cross back into the guide. Yeah. Good.
Just a wonderful, wonderful case to show.
Dumb. Not happy with this war.
Just Fogarty, what do you want to do? Let's see. Good. Okay. Take a sine.
Okay. Guard liner is out. Okay, go. Yeah.
Good.
So what's happening, do you think, in the mid region? That's the point where you have re-entered?
Yeah, that's it. Yeah. Okay. Now let's take this balloon out, right?
So you want to do something to the diagonal first and then stent across?
Right. Yep. And rest we will leave this further. We have a 4.5 balloon. Yep.
Samin, would you want to dilate in the mid portion of the LAD there before, or you're going to stent across it?
We just have to stent it across. Yeah, yeah.
Okay. We have to stent that level.
With the two wires, won't be able to put any stent now.
Yeah. Right.
No. After the diagonal, we'll take everything out.
Okay. Diagonal dissection.
Yep. Good. So what we need to do, okay, this is one by one.
This is the grand slam.
Yeah, leave it here.
Get us
on one side.
2.5 to the diag, right? You have the 2.5 balloon to the diag?
Yep.
Get us a 2.75-38, right?
Yep.
For the LED?
Yeah.
2.5.
Get 2.75, 38 promos element.
Yeah. We'll lose everything. Zines.
That's which one is the?
This is the fielder.
Huh?
Fielder for the diag.
Okay, let's go. Fielder.
So a larger balloon to dilate the diagonal first.
We're just going to dilate.
So that
because the
have a provisional stenting strategy in mind.
No, it has to be.
Here we just leave dissection. Whatever leave the diagonal is, right. We'll take it.
Right, okay.
So in this case, we're just going to dilate that area and put a stent across.
Focus on the LED.
Yeah, exactly.
So very large vessel.
If need to be, that we'll bring this patient back later on. And again, in this case, don't put too many stents. If need to bring patient back later, maybe a better choice than putting a too many stents now. Okay, good. We're dilating.
Severe tortuosity there, which
Done. Even his aorta very tortuous. Done.
So part of that may be related to his rheumatoid arthritis. He's on methotrexate and that. Yeah, sulfasinazole. Yeah, good here.
You want to put a stent in there, the LED
there
or
you
leave
go.
It?
Now you appreciate the tortuosity which is giving us.
Two will not cover. From there to there will be three now.
Now what we'll do is the distal we can leave alone. I think still there's a part of the dissection which will heal. But I don't think we need to cover entire area of the mid LED. What we learned, so that's what.
I mean, mid to distal, go.
Yeah. The mid to distal and one proximal and then rest we'll just see later.
Samin, what is the maximum number of stents you've deployed in a patient?
No, I mean the rare cases I would say maybe 7-8, but as you saw the last week in India I put a 6 absorb stent on a patient which made a big headline in Times of India and everywhere.
Was it the nation's most expensive angioplasty?
Yeah. But the patient actually was very clear that no metallic stent. Yeah, let's go. I think we just put one there and then we'll see proximally.
One where?
Yeah. Mid?
No, mid, what you're talking?
Mid to distal, yeah.
Yeah.
Until this level, yeah.
If you go there and there too?
Yeah.
Proximal. Okay, you have the 38?
Yeah.
But those six.
You want to take now everything out? Dye has to come out if you are leaving the guideliner. We need the guideliner.
Yeah, but no, we don't need the guideliner also. Or you can leave the guideliner, yeah, take the dye wire out. Yeah.
No, leave it.
Huh? Take the wire out, it will be very tough.
Lose it?
It's out. Okay. All right. So let's hopefully we get to towards completion. It's again another CTO case which have gone almost 100 minutes. But they had to go through all the steps. Sometimes it takes more time. Purpose here is that let everybody be comfortable, see it. Now what our goal will be now, try to put two stents and leave the distal area, even if it's unstented, uncovered, maybe just with a balloon dilatation of the dissected area, if we can get through.
More challenges there, huh?
Okay. Now you need a high pressure.
Mm.
Okay, get a 2.520 high pressure.
So that's the probably a little calcification at the...
That created a lot of trouble. Yeah,
right.
Let's come out.
Calcification and tortuosity at the...
No, 2.5, 3.0.
2.5. Huh? We are 2.5 right now, but remember we are now not done. We have done the diagonal level with a 2.520 balloon, but we are not done in the LED level. So that's what we need to do, that angle. Angle is the one which was very difficult.
I understand Dr. Fuster is going to be coming at the end of the case to provide a little summary.
We actually they're trying to get expert opinion of a non-interventionalist, particularly that how the message we try to convey in each
the ultimate heart team.
Ultimate heart team.
All right, that was a good decision. You're across with the high pressure.
Yes, get to the
beyond that maximum, tortuosity.
Yeah. Yep.
So the distal cap at this moment has been fractured with the balloon.
That's
without
it.
A doubt.
Yeah.
There you go. That was what was preventing.
One little proximal too. Good. Want to put more proximal?
No, we're good.
We did already there.
Yeah, we did. Go up there now.
Okay, 18. Good.
And the patient never really became ischemic with the guideliner in position.
No, he actually does have very small ST changes.
Right.
But I think part of that is the dissection we have created. He does have one millimeter.
It's okay now.
I'm still a little unclear as to why don't you want to get a perfect result by stenting even the mid portion.
Yeah, we might have to. I mean, more and more I'm thinking that
if you could finish the whole.
Cover it, yeah. And only thing then will be left is the diagonal, which we can, patient can get a little extra dose of the metoprolol XL. And
see how the follow-up stress test demonstrates. You've got a nice comparator there from before.
Exactly.
Anu, absolutely outstanding skills, just ability to have clear thinking through difficult cases, live transmissions. Hopefully the viewers have found it extremely beneficial.
Not that
your struggles have stopped.
Get the guideline removed.
Yes, you are still.
Yep.
Good.
There we go.
And breathe normally. Now, question is, do you want to pull back a little bit?
No, I think, look at that. That's where you have to start. Another 38 will cover it, yeah.
No, will not cover. Okay, see the previous
look to be all right distally.
See the branch there, right?
There was a disease until there. Yeah, minus here. See this. in relation to the
branch. I think you're exactly right there. The branch, the septal, and
back,
the diagonals.
This will be all dissection.
Okay, fine.
Go.
That's fine. Let's go. Okay, it's a 2.7538 Zion's expedition. Clearly, very good 10 atmosphere, nicely expanded.
Now we hear.
This is all the way there.
Yeah.
So, I mean, some of your events in the cath lab, we hear through journals. So it appears you were the first person in the country to use the expedition.
Yes, we actually were for both for the Zions. That was on July 2nd, 2009. Yeah, good. Yeah, a little further. And the expedition, yes. Except that I could not become the first person to use the absorb in United States. That's the only problem.
So if that's the only negative on your CV, don't feel bad.
Okay. Now let's see, we need to decide what we are going to do. You want to take after this guideliner out also, so we have a better picture and so?
No. Guideliner is okay. Very important here.
Fine. Okay. Just fascinating watching both of you you know, go through this processes of mildly challenging each other, agreeing and disagreeing, and that's absolutely outstanding placement of the distal stent there.
You're doing it 38 or 33?
No, 38. 3 or 38, right?
Yep. And actually, the diagonal looks all right. There's a little little dissection at the origin of the diagonal.
The perf is saying. Robert Pai is not there? Yeah, we are.
Anybody else can go? Yeah.
Cannot. No, that
38 too long distally, you think? Or
yeah.
You?
No, but I think we'll be okay. It worked out very good. We're going to put our.
Where? Show me. Where's the perf?
Here.
Of a bypass case.
Yeah.
Yeah, don't get, nothing will happen. Where is your balloon?
Balloon is inflated right now. See?
Good.
No, so this is, Sameen, the ultimate multitasking. Anu moves outside to focus attention to.
You just have to occlude it.
Yeah, we the same, you know, we try to work it out.
Absolutely.
Everybody has a good team. They need help, another side apparently, so that she has gone out.
Excellent.
And I'll complete it here.
Fantastic.
Okay. I think good. 1 millimeter overlap. There is a. We are risking the diagonal, but I think we'll be okay with that. Yeah, go up.
The diagonal I noticed has good flow. There is a little dissection.
But no, but it will close now. It will close. Yeah. The 12. 14.
So this is the 38
negative.
Also?
Yep.
Okay.
And put a verapamil there. Yeah, this is a 3038. So we have put a two expeditions. Clearly that these kind of cases, I would say that any other stent of the Zion's variety before would have been a trouble.
You,
but now these
you're going to post-dilate this.
That we can do. Go 20. Yeah.
So now you've gone beyond so that you overlap the
area,
the dilate the overlapping segment.
Good.
Yeah.
Okay. Like it.
So Anu, everything all right in the case in the other room?
Yeah, they're having some issues, so
okay.
We have to just finish this quickly.
Excellent. Anu, how many CTOs are you averaging a week now?
Between the two of us, 5 to 7.
Okay.
Also, what has happened, I mean, we have a lot of other doctors who come to Sinai to do cases, so they, some of them...
You end up scrubbing
with them, and then some of them, you know, cath outside hospital, so they bring all the CTOs here.
Sameen, I also noticed you need a bigger board there. 60 names don't fit on that screen.
I know. I was just, you know, and then we keep changing the names. I said, I'm talking to our hospital president, we have made enough money. We can hire somebody like Vanna White to change the names and up and down. Keep it very interesting.
All right, I think let's try to see.
Low mat.
You're going to have a visual delight looking at this.
Well, let's see.
I have no doubt. There you go.
All right.
All the septals are preserved.
Septals are preserved, diagonal has flowed.
Yep. And that actually is the advantage of the Zion's expedition and so that keeping all the side branches. We know the diagonal has a slow flow, but that's okay. That's the only thing we leave in this particular case.
Take these out.
I'll not take a good picture with the. That's a very good, in my opinion, that we are way ahead of the game, just leaving the diagonal. We're going to take the wire out.
Sameen, question for you has come. I cannot track down the origin of the question. Dr. Maher Ayubi could be from the Middle East. What is your indication for 2B3A inhibitors for such cases and in general?
These cases should not.
This case is absolutely contraindicated.
Contraindicated.
Because your wires have gone to so many smaller branches. And those are the cases where you will end up with a delayed wire perforation.
Maher, a very relevant question and a clear answer for you. Second part of the question is, what is your indication for elective cases of bivalirudin? I quite don't fully understand.
But replace two was elective cases.
I suspect the question is bivalirudin for CTOs, which we previously answered.
Yeah.
Looks absolutely magnificent, flow in the diagonal.
Yep. Is there, and I think we leave the diagonal alone for the future. Now, this kind of a high-risk case,
absolutely. What
we will do is we'll bring back in about 5-6 months, because I don't want him to have total occlusion again, in 5 months, and we'll bring this patient back to an angiogram, at that time take care of the diagonal. But mega LED, excellent angiographic result, and we can just sum it up. We quickly come back to our slide presentation. That predictor of CTO success and the correlation of various non-invasive studies. In the current era of CTO recanalization, angiographic predictor of failures are few, even a long lesion like this. Important being the heavy calcium, that has been our experience. Subintimal tracking is associated with high reocclusion rates and hence should be avoided. Unsuccessful recanalization is still associated with higher MACE rate, which we understand. Second, the recent data suggests IVUS lumen cross-sectional area of 3.1 millimeter square to correlate with FFR of 0.8 and is dependent on referral vessel diameter. OCT provides on an average 1 millimeter smaller lumen area compared to IVUS, and hence OCT criteria for hemodynamic significant lesion may be different than IVUS criteria. But most important is IVUS and FFR has a very poor correlation. Quickly, the three questions. One, following are the predictors of successful recanalization of the CTO lesions except tapered end, heavy calcification, no bridge collaterals, and short occlusion. We have spoken about it. Second, the recent multi-center registry showed success of CTO2B less than 50%, 50 to 70, 71 to 85, and more than 85%. And the third is, following observation about FFR and IVUS correlation was noted in the first study, that there is a fixed relationship with RVD and FFR of 0.8. There is a good correlation of IVUS MLD and FFR. FFR cutoff of 0.8 will lead to less PCI versus IVUS MLD cutoff. Virtual histology parameters on IVUS correlate well with FFR of 0.8. This is actually part of the first study. There were virtual histology did not correlate with any of the FFR and IVUS FFR parameters. So with that note, Anu, you want to just put your last word and we end this long, extensive case.
Yeah, just some tips I would say. If you see this angiogram right from the beginning, we knew that guide support would have been a trouble. That's why you should have the guideliner with us ready to make sure. And here, if you see, what would be the wire selection in this kind of a case? We know we have a side branch, so take advantage of the side branch. Go with your soft wire or a regular workhorse wire into the side branch, come with a fine cross, and when after that the next step is you go with your stiff wire, whether they are usually the miracles, miracle, go with the stiff wire, and you see like a little beak there, that is probably positive for us in this case, to just hit the beak with a positive. Don't even try with the soft wire, which is fielder XT kind of wire, thinking that there may be some kind of a channel. It'll be negative, waste of time. So go with the stiff wire, which was miracle. We used miracle 6 here, and we got into the lumen. But when you reach the bifurcation, since we truly didn't know how the LED was traversing, and we know it was angulated, we got into the diag, take it, dilate it, and that's where you take a challenge. Means when you dilate it, either you have good, you created less dissection, you are able to get into the true lumen of the LED versus what we saw here. We created so much dissection that we were challenged to get into the LED. Then the challenge is which wire would you select to go into the LED? Always go with your soft wires, which are either fielder, whisper, to get into the LED. If they don't work, then you go with the stiffer wire. Since it was an angulated LED with the dissection, the wire of choice had to be a pilot. It is same, it's kind of a fielder but a stiffer tip. You saw how the pilot made a turn, but again, the dissection was our biggest negative point, that we kept going into the dissection plane. So when we were deciding to turn into the LED, always go with the fine cross, knowing that you may have to change your wire strategies. With the pilot, we made the turn, but again we were subintimal. Once you're subintimal, again, first choice, if you can use your soft tip wires, so that without creating more trauma, that you'll get into the lumen. If not, to re-entry, other than the cross-pos device, if you have the, you use with your stiffer wires, which are either the Confianzas, or if not the Confianza, which is 9-12, the next what we showed here was the Progress. Progress is probably the stiffest wire that is available right now in America, which is 14 gram tip. It's a combination, it's a tapered tip, so it's a combination of Confianza as well as a fielder. So with that, we were able to get into the true lumen here. So just to go over the steps, what went through my mind to go through this challenging case, and how, what kind of wire selection you will do.
Anu, it's a beautiful case and exceptionally lovely summary highlighting just about everything you do. And I'm glad that you covered the decision of the Progress wire also. Sameen, final words for you?
That's it. As I said, will be a little disappointment that we won't show this case again. We took extra time and showed it today. And with that note, I really thank all the viewers to stay around and keep asking questions and challenging us. And that's the really way learning for everyone.
Absolutely exceptional case. Congratulations to you, to Anu, and to your team. Please join us during the next webcast, which is May the 21st.